Today we're very lucky to have with us Bodil Stokke. Bodil is a serious speaker for those of you that don't know her.
She's a serious speaker. Today I learned.
She's a very strong proponent of the Church of Emacs, functional programming, and the Free Software Foundation, which is what the talk will cover a little bit today. I could go on more about her, but she was kind enough to provide a personal summary for the meetup, and it's arguably one of the most spectacular, rich summaries I've seen by a technical speaker. So I'll leave it to that. You can go check it out without further ado.
Thank you. Two, that's a really cool talk. So that aside, let's just get started. I'm going to start by telling you a little story, sort of to set the scene. Actually, this is the origin story of the entire open source and free software movement, how it came about. It was back in the early 1970s, the Xerox Corporation just invented a thing called I guess, the photocopier. And they had figured out that sort of the outputs end of the photocopier could be connected to a computer, sort of, to actually work with a printer. And so this was brand new and science fiction-y at the time. So what these companies would do when they invented something new that hackers would like, they would often donate one to an academic institution or a research lab or something, just so the hackers would get at it and have fun with it and give them lots of feedback. And very often they would write drivers for it and whatnot, and the companies could just sort of, because back in the day they would just be, they didn't really have an idea that programs, that their computer code was something that should be scarce and monetized. So people were just sharing code freely, the product was the hardware. And so they donated one to the artificial intelligence lab at MIT. And there was a hacker named Richard, of whom this story is about. And one day, Richard wanted to print something. He had a 50-page paper or something like that that he wanted to send up to the printer. This newfangled Xerox printer was a lot faster, like 20 times faster than the previous printer they had. But it was still going to take a while to print 50 pages. And there might be other people printing before him and so on. So he just sent it off to the system, and an hour or so later, he went to the printer to collect his paper. And instead of his 50 pages, he found 4 pages. And they weren't even his own pages, they were the previous person's pages. And the printer had jammed. Now, Richard knew how to fix this, because the previous printer had the same problem. also had a lot of other problems, like not being able to print circles. They came out sort of squished and straight lines for sort of sine waves. But the new one was a lot better in that regard. However, this was essentially a photocopier without the input part. And with a photocopier, you tend to actually be present when it's being used. And so you can very quickly and efficiently deal with jams because you're there and you can see it happen. Whereas with this thing, the engineers that built it had essentially not cared a lot about getting the mechanics right and avoiding jams because, you know, they didn't think they needed to. So this was sort of a built-in defect. But Richard knew how to fix this because the previous printer had, as I said, a similar problem. There would be a lot of jams. So what he had done previously is that he had gone to the printer's control software on one of the university's mainframes, and he'd made a little patch to the program that would occasionally just pull the printer to see if it was jammed. And if it was jammed, it would email everybody in the print queue. The printer has now jammed, you'll need to go fix it. And usually because the people in the print queue were anxious to get the print jobs done, somebody would show up to fix it very quickly. And so he hadn't actually fixed the engineering problem that would cause the jams, but he'd written sort of a software patch that would sort of get around it. So Richard thought, well, let's do the same thing for this new printer. So he went to find the software for the new printer, and he found only a binary blob, no source code that he could modify. And Richard was very sad. So, I mean, he had his connections, he'd been in the industry for a while, in academia, I guess, for a while. And he knew basically who to talk to figure out whether he might get the source code, because for some reason, just asking Xerox didn't occur to him. And so eventually, he managed to set up a meeting with a researcher who was now at Carnegie Mellon, I think. So Richard, a couple of months later, found himself another business at Carnegie, and he set up a meeting with this researcher who had actually written the software for the Xerox photocopying printer. So Richard went to this fellow's office, and he said, hey, we got one of these printers that you wrote the software for, and I'd like to modify the software a bit. Could you give me the source code for that? And he was expecting, like, in the past, this would not have been an issue at all. He would just have gotten the software. But this fellow told Richard that, I'm sorry, I can't do that. It's proprietary software, and I'm contractually obliged to keep it a secret. And Richard was stunned. For one thing, he was socially awkward, being a hacker and all. That's what hackers are, you know. You've seen this in movies, right? So he wasn't quite sure how to handle rejection in the general case, but the fact that this very unexpected thing had happened, that suddenly he was going to be denied the ability to modify the software that he was using, he was totally unprepared for that. So he got mad, he got really angry, very, very, very upset. And, well, being a socially awkward hacker and all that, he didn't know how to handle being that angry, so he just turned around and left without a word, as the story goes. And he went back to MIT, and he started the Free Software Foundation. To cut a long story short, essentially, this encounter made him realize that software needed to be modifiable by the people who use it. And hiding away the knowledge of how software works behind proprietary licenses was going to be very harmful in the long run. And also he was just personally very upset, which I think was mostly what drove him in the first years. So, after this came the Free Software Foundation, which he founded as a result of this. And he went on to write something called the GNU General Public License. He's a GNUs. I think those are actually cows, the emoji. I don't think we have an official GNU emoji. Who's there also called Wildebeest? Just to be clear on this. Last time I gave this talk, somebody was very confused by this picture. What are these weird looking cows? And now I've heard of Wildebeest before, but that is what they are. That is also beside the point. The General Public License was probably the first license that we today think of as open source. It is also a free software license, and Richard is very particular about the difference between free software and open source, and I'm not going to go into it. He could for hours on end. The GPL is essentially about how if you use a piece of software, you are allowed to possess the source code for it. If you receive a binary, the license says, you must also be able to receive a source code. It's not necessarily distributed with a binary, but it needs to be distributed with a way for you to get the source code easily, if you get the binary. And there are all these things about the four freedoms of the freedom to modify, the freedom to share, to share further, and so on. I won't go into the details. So the Free Software Foundation went on, it started in the early 80s, I believe, and it went on mostly unregarded in academic circles for over a decade until it started to go mainstream finally. So this was the best picture I could think of to illustrate the concept of mainstream. Have to forgive me for that, because I can't fully see in this terrible place. So essentially, in 1991, there was this fellow called Linus Torvalds, who wrote a thing called Linux, and slapped the GNU General Public License on it. Now, Richard had actually been trying to build an operating system inside the Free Software Foundation for quite a while. And he had never quite gotten to the kernel part, like the core of the operating system. And Linux happened to fit the bill, and it had a GPL on it randomly. Linus just basically wanted to share it. He didn't really think politically in the way that Richard did, but they sort of had similar goals, and they became fast friends in the practical sense anyway. And this sort of gave the idea of wings. At a later point, a couple of years later, Netscape, you might remember they wrote a browser once, and they sort of turned into the Mozilla Foundation. Netscape had a browser. The browser was proprietary, but they decided they were going to publish the source, make it freely available. And about the same time, and actually I believe these people have been pushing Netscape in this direction. There were people from Netscape involved in this movement. The movement is the Open Source Initiative, as it's known today, which had a more pragmatic view than Richard did on the idea that we should be publishing and sharing our code. Essentially, Richard was political. Richard wanted everybody to have the right to use and modify the software they were using. The open source people were more of a mind that, okay, if we publish software and we can look at the source, we can audit it, we can make sure that it doesn't have any bugs, or if there are bugs, we can submit patches back. Basically, the argument was, if a company open sources its code, then people are going to come to them and have them work on it, essentially free labour. So, let's see, yeah, this is the next slide. There was this fellow called Eric Raymond who wrote, I don't know if it's a book or an essay, I suppose it's an essay, it's been published as a book called The Cathedral and the Bazaar, where he makes this argument that proprietorship software is the cathedral. It's all very fancily engineered and all that, but there's no back and forth between the user and the developer, or the user who is able to provide feedback and the developer. Whereas in the bazaar, the open source world, there was a constant dialogue which helped grow and make products better, essentially. So, the open source initiative didn't really care for Richard's GPL license, because it restricts how companies can sort of can utilize the free labor that they're getting. So they were advocating more frequently the BSD license, the MIT license, the X11 license, and a lot of other licenses which don't go into detail about the four freedoms and Richard's grand mission. They just say, hey, you can use my software, here's the source code, do what you want with it. Except don't sue me. That's usually the only legal language that these licenses can take. Basically, do what you like, except sue me for it. Like, the idea is, I wrote this up, maybe it's useful to you, I'm not giving you any guarantees. If you use it, it's on you. But hey, at least I'm sharing. So that was the open source movement. This is, we're in about 1995-ish now. And since then it's grown into something rather different. Today it's not about politics in Richard's sense, it's not about pragmatism in Eric Raymond's sense. It's become more of an expression of art, sort of a performance art kind of thing. Like, I publish open source because I want you to see the cool shit that I made, right? We're still kind of getting a grip on what this movement is actually doing nowadays. But in my mind, it looks like art, and that's really awesome. But that was the history. And here comes the difficult part of the talk. This is where I try to explain to you why I think this is so very, very important. And why I believe in free software and open source and all these things. Because what this really does is it gives us agency. This is the best gift I can think of for agency. As in, we are able to act. We are able to share our knowledge freely. And we are able to, anybody is able to look at our knowledge and learn from it as they please. And thus, get the same agency that we got from actually learning how to do these things. And just think about what a world would be like if Richard didn't have a bad experience with a printer fellow, or nobody thought of the idea of open source at all, suppose. Imagine a world where all software is proprietary. What does that really mean? So, here he is again, by the way, I'm sorry. Also, yeah, I like this emoji for like a corporate world. But I'm going to tell you another story. This was in the early 21st century, before the bombs fell, probably. There was this fellow who wanted to build a spaceship and go to Mars and colonize the planet. This fellow owned a company. He wasn't at NASA or anything like that. He had founded a company called SpaceX. This company was into commercial spaceflight. They're building rockets so they can put satellites into orbit, and his grand vision is they're going to build rockets that can actually send people to Mars and colonize it, which is awesome, right? This is like the next step for humanity into the grand future, unless we blow ourselves up first, which could totally happen. Now, fortunately, this fellow has been pretty good on spreading the knowledge that he's acquiring. He's also got a company where he builds cars with batteries in them. And he's actually open sourced all the technology that he used to build these cars. the patents that this other company has got, Tesla, has acquired over the years have actually been open source in the sense that everybody is now allowed to use the technology, which is great. But imagine if this wasn't this fellow, but some other fellow with a less enlightened view on sharing the knowledge. Suppose that the technology that we acquired to actually go to Mars and colonize the planet was proprietary and controlled by a single company. And what if that company vanishes? What happens to the future of humanity? This horrifies me. Which is why open source really matters to me as a programmer. Because we have the power not only to create, we can build on other people's work to produce awesome applications, new ways of building awesome applications, and so on. But not only to create, but we have the power to learn. This is the crucial bit, because all the knowledge that's out there, open source, doesn't matter if it's MIT licensed or GPL licensed, we can all go and look at it, we can all go and learn from it. Anybody can do it, not just people who have gone to university to be programmers. Anybody who decides they want to be a programmer can go and look at all this wonderful knowledge and acquire it, because it's right there. And how we protect that actually really matters, and this is where I get technical about licenses and so on. Because what we're protecting is the knowledge. It's not the software that we're writing, it's the knowledge that goes into building it. So I'm going to obviously plug the GPL and the Glorious People's License, so that we it's one more slide. The focus of the GPL is making sure that the knowledge stays out there. More so than licenses like MIT, where basically you're allowed to do anything you like, including adapting the source code that you find into your own proprietary product. So the thing that the person who used the MIT license built is still available, but the things that they built on top of it aren't. Well, it's a GPL. This is why corporations don't like it, obviously. The GPL disallows that. It says that whenever you make a modification to a piece of software that has got the GPL in it, you have to publish that modification so that other people can benefit from it as well. So essentially, if you feel that bit really matters, then you should be using the GPL on your software. If you feel maybe, okay, we should be a little bit more pragmatic, I would recommend you use the Mozilla public license over things like MIT and BSD. The Mozilla license is just as permissive as MIT. It's basically written by more lawyers. It has language for how to deal with patents and so on. That basically protects both the publisher of a piece of software and the user of it a little bit better than just MIT can, without having all the restrictions in order to preserve our freedoms as the GPL does. If you're actually not writing software, but just producing art or literature or whatever, then the CC share alike license, the Creative Commons license with a share alike clause, has sort of the same effect as the GPL. That means that anybody who takes your work and adapts it has to publish it under the same license. So the art is preserved as well as the knowledge. Now here comes the really difficult bit, because it would be really dishonest of me to come in here and tell you grand stories about Richard without admitting that sometimes Richard can be a bit of a ding-dong, as the Americans called him. I didn't know how to express it when I did this talk the first time in New York. And I stumbled a bit, and somebody put up their hands and said, "He's a ding-dong." Which I think essentially means that. So Richard sometimes says stupid things.
And ESR and Linus.
Oh yeah, that's a totally different story. I won't go into him at all. So Richard sometimes says things that upsets people. I think overall, Richard is actually He's not malicious, he's just from the 70s. I mean, the things he sometimes says are bad, but I don't think they're meant maliciously at all. I'm not saying you should forgive him, but whatever, he's a dingo. Now, he's sort of been a hero of mine for the past 25 years since I discovered that the GPL existed. And every time he does one of these things, he becomes less of a hero. But that's not... So the thing is, sometimes this reflects very badly on free software as a movement. And I won't even go into Eric Raymond and the open source movement. Eric Raymond is a... Yeah, let's not talk about that at all. If you want, you can Google it and be horrified. But that is not the point. Our heroes are imperfect, but what matters is the movement and the need to preserve the knowledge for, literally for humanity. So, if Richard is going to be a ding-dong and the Free Software Foundation is going to be ding-dongy as a result, fine, you know what we need to do? We do not drop the idea of free software. We make our own movements. We make new and better movements. We might even want to consider making a movement out of the thing that open source has become now, which doesn't really share Richard's ideas, it doesn't really share the open source movement's ideas. It's sort of become a new thing, and perhaps it's time for a new movement for that. But whatever we do not give up on the knowledge. That is so crucial. This is how, for one thing, we as developers keep on developing ourselves, our own skills. We need to be able to see what's happening in the world. We need to be able to go out there and look at new technologies and be able to learn from them and take what we learn back and building to build our own software. So, that was it. That makes sense at all. Obviously, I'm ending with a dog going to space. It's a Shiba Inu, actually. This is actually in space. I believe this is on. There's this plate that goes into like low Earth orbit or something, and then you're weightless for a little bit. And somebody brought a dog on board. It's okay. It's going to Mars. Right.
Okay. I think we have a question here.
I was going to say, historically, like you said, most software was like passed around on CDs or floppy disks or whatever.
Before even floppy disks.
Yeah, exactly. It was a physical thing, right? A lot of what you access now is like down a wire, and then you get some stuff back, and then it appears on your screen. And so there's a lot of proprietary software running inside those things, or open source software, but they're not under any of the same obligation. I wonder if that's a bit of a challenge to the model of kind of publishing stuff, if you're just delivering software as a service.
Yeah, so there is the thing called the Affero, public license, which is sort of an attempt to extend the GPL into the idea that, okay, if you're not actually in possession of this piece of software, if you're just talking to it over the internet, then the license still applies, as it were. The AGPL is a strange beast, and I believe still untested in court, but it tries to address this idea that nowadays sort of the topology of sharing software has changed a bit. And I think also the idea of the internet itself has changed how we think of sharing software, because essentially you mentioned CDs and floppy disks, which creates sort of an artificial scarcity for information, because you need to store it on this movable media, this physical media. Whereas with the internet, everything's on Google, and everything that isn't on Google is on Wikipedia and Facebook and whatnot. And so it's very easy to extend that idea into software that, why shouldn't it be open source? It's so easy to get to. It's not like if I'm copying it, I'm stealing it. It's right there. And I guess I keep talking about the art movement of open source that I think is emerging this is just a wild hypothesis of mine, but it's definitely changed a lot since the 90s. And I think that is all down to the internet. Perhaps the original of the social revolution of the 90s wouldn't even have happened without the internet, but it was, back then it was just, as old E says, like, the population of the internet now is pretty much, what is it, 1/3 of the entire population of the world? Perhaps I'm being optimistic there, but it's billions of people anyway. Back then we were talking thousands of people. It's a different world entirely. And it's going to be so interesting to see how it turns out. And hopefully we don't screw it up completely. Any other questions?
Yeah. Do you see maybe a way the way we manage open source these days, maybe the next couple of decades, how it influences the way we do business or share resources in the future? Is there a blueprint for this maybe?
Yeah, that's just a very interesting question, because I could do another talk on this. I probably shouldn't. How much time have we got? Yeah, I probably shouldn't. Yeah, for one thing, the way open source is being built today is tricky, because for one thing, a lot of people don't get paid for it. Most people do it on their spare time, and they're fortunate that they're able to, and a lot of people aren't. This is a problem. We need to be able to figure out how to monetize it a little better, at least within the capitalist system. I said I wouldn't go there. So we need to just have a serious look at, I think this is perhaps the most crucial stumbling block for the movement going forward, that we don't know how to make sure that the people who write open source can be fed, literally. I don't have a solution to that. I really hope somebody's going to come up with a great answer soon. But was there another part of your question?
Yeah, well, do you think it could also influence the way we do business in general?
I think it should. You mean like doing business in an open source manner? I'm not even sure what that would look like.
Yeah, I don't know.
That is a deep question.
I'm sorry.
That's good. Well, I mean, the ideas of open source and sharing knowledge in general is not, it shouldn't be just about us programmers. It should be about everybody doing research about how it applies to like literal capitalism. I mean, there's science in that too, but I
don't know. There's potential,
huh?
There's potential, no?
I hope so, anyway. And there's a lot of thinking to be done there. I haven't done that thinking. If you figure it out, be sure to let me know and I'll tell everybody about it.
Hey, there's no other questions.
Big thank you again for a very inspiring topic.